Good day. My name is Guy Mutsaerts. I'm working for Goudsmit Magnetic Systems in Waalre, the Netherlands. In this short video presentation, I want to give you the relation between the flux density and the separation result. The reason why I do this is because we go to clients and we measure their magnets. And then we come back and we say, your magnet has a value of so many Gauss. But what does that say to you? The other reason is that a lot of people think that a high Gauss value will give a better separation than a low Gauss value. That's also not totally true. I want to start with a photo that I made with a client. And what you see on this photo is the specification was 10,000 Gauss, must be more than 10,000 Gauss. And it's true, because the grid that you see here has a very high Gauss value. I think about above 12,000 Gauss. But what you also see is that you see rust on the pole plates. You see a broken magnet. That's something that you don't want in the food industry. But also the distance between the bars is quite high. And there you get a gap where you have a non-magnetic area, so parts can fall through. Another thing, what you see here is that the bars are quite long and the grid is quite heavy, so it's impossible to clean it. So what you actually saw, that you specified only the Gauss value, but you forgot to specify a lot of other very important things. Let me start with the main thing, the open pole system. I see them a lot, but it's very dangerous and not acceptable for the food. But why do you people make that open pole system? It's very logical. Because if I can measure directly my bar on the magnet, this is my probe on the magnet, I have a very high Gauss value, and that's what you ask for, so they make it. But what you need is a smooth surface where no bacteria or pollution can come in, and that's easy cleanable. That's what you need. I see this. You can see this in the next graphic, what is happening when you have an air gap with your Gauss meter. You see here on the graphic that if you have start and you have only half of a millimeter of air gap between your Gauss meter and your magnet, I already lose 50% of my flux density, which is very high. So the reason why people make an open pole is to have a high Gauss value, but for you it's not acceptable. So don't ask for this only. You also need to specify then what the rest should be. That's one part. Now we go to the second part. Because what's also very important for you is to understand what can that Gauss value do for me. Now, we started then to do a test with just one simple bar. We made a test model where we had a chute and we put in that chute on the top parts of 0.8 by 3 millimeter. Those parts were slide to the bar, which is under it, and we can reproduce this test very easily. So with this test model, we could make every time the same test with iron, stainless steel 304 and 316. We use every time 50 pieces. What we also did, and it's also nice to see here, is that we could move the slide away from the bar in horizontal direction. And one time the slide is just above the pole plate, where the Gauss value is very high, and the other time the slide is just in the middle of the pole plates, where the Gauss value is much lower, probably around zero. This is a test where you can see only with one bar in one circumstances. So I don't have any influence from product speed or from flow or for sticky products. This is just to see where are the borders, so where is my maximum. And that's very interesting to know, because then you know what you can do and what you can't do. Out of this test result, we have this graphic. On the vertical line, you see the percentages in of caught metal parts. So on the left, you see 100% on the top and nil on the bottom. In the corner, you see the bar. It's around 25 millimeters. And then on the right, on the X shaft, we see the distance from the bar. So every time that we moved the slide shoot away, we measured it on every point, every millimeter we measured. On the right side of your slide, you see steel. You see that steel cannot be caught anymore when the Gauss value is below 155 Gauss. And it still has an air gap of about 25 millimeters from the bar. If we focus on stainless steel 304, We see that for stainless steel 304, I need 1100 Gauss, and I still have an air gap of about 11-12 millimeters. To trap stainless steel 316 is very, very difficult, because you see already that you have to hit the bar before to have a chance, but also when you hit the bar, some parts are also missing, and there the Gauss value is 10,000 Gauss. So this graphic is very important to give inside information. Now we know if you have less than 155 Gauss, you will not catch iron at all. We say in our systems that we want to have at least 300 Gauss if you want to catch iron. For stainless steel 304, you need 1100 Gauss. What is also nice, what you see here, there is an air gap possible to trap stainless steel 304. And that's why it's not such a big problem if you measure on the bar or just away from the bar. So if you measure directly on the open pole or you measure on the stainless steel tube of your bar, it will give the same separation result. It won't change your results. We have done many tests to prove this, and we see this on this graphic here. You see here that we have several systems made, and on the left you see systems with 12,000 and 11,400 Gauss. Good systems, top-class systems, where we have a separation degree of above 90% of stainless steel 304. But also, on the fourth graphic, you see a system which only 8,000 Gauss has a better performance than the third graphic with 12,000 Gauss. So it's not always the Gauss value which makes it. It's the air gap which makes the difference here between those figures. What you also see, and that's true for all the things, if you want to trap stainless steel 316, you need high Gauss values. A lot of conclusions are made, but in your specification you are focused on Gauss value. But the Gauss value should be more, it should be that you don't want an open pole, and you also have to define the air gap between the bars, so that you don't have a minimum of Gauss. And we say you need at least 300 Gauss as a minimum to be effective. Okay, now I want to tell you another problem, and it's how can you verify it and how can you measure it? Now, the first problem that we meet is, and we go back to this slide, and you saw that in the first half millimeter you lose 50% of your Gauss value. But if you see the other photo to the right, then you can also have different probes, a thick probe and a thin probe. A thick probe will measure less than a thin probe, and it affects directly. So if 10 people are using the same probe, you will have 10 different results. But if you are measuring further away, because after 2 millimeters that line gets stable, you will have a more stable result. So measuring is also a problem. And everybody thinks that it's very exact, but it's not. It are both calibrated Gauss meters, but you have different results. If you are capable of measuring it away in the air gap, where you need a certain to catch a certain part, then it will be more stable, but it's very difficult. Now, what can we do to help you? Now, first, what we can do is that we can give you a certificate where we say that the minimum Gauss value in our system is 300 Gauss. This certificate is only coming from us, and you cannot verify it. So we need to think, how can you test it? You have two possibilities. You can use the normal Gauss meter, as you have, and you can measure on a distance, then you know exactly what it is. But we know out of practice, it's not so easy. So we looked further, and we found out a new Gauss meter. It's a 3D Gauss meter. It looks like this. It's a meter that has a probe, where you can sensor to all directions. And what do we do? We make a setting here of 300 Gauss, and we move that probe in our system, and we look if the system is checking if there is 300 or not. If you come closer, it's 300. If you are here, it's not 300. But if it's not 300, we say it's not good. This is a total new measuring method. We are starting with that, and it's also quite complicated. It's a lot of work for you. What we actually want to achieve is that we can make a model in our computer. Our problem at the moment is that we have to define your product into our computer, so air with milk powder or air with cocoa powder. But the advantage for us is that we can change the parameters like speed, like drag force, like particle size or the size of particles that you want to catch, stainless steel in 304, and it makes it much more quicker. That will be the next step where we are working on. But for the time being, you have to work with the Gauss meters to verify it. And you also have to understand is that you shouldn't only focus on the high Gauss value, as we did in the first slide, but we also have to focus on the closed pole. This is really very important. So no open pole anymore. And you should also define, what do you want to catch? Do I want to catch iron or do I want to catch stainless steel 304? Stainless steel 316 is just very, very difficult. And you always need extra systems to trap those particles. There are a lot of more videos about how to measure magnets, why are parts coming to the magnet, that's called force index, different systems, block systems, bar systems, on the video channel of Goudsmit on YouTube. If you have questions, don't hesitate to contact us or have a look at our website. Thank you very much.